Now I invite Reverend Father Reggie P. Kurian, the principal of St. Berkman's College, to deliver the welcome address.
Dear and respected Professor Noam Chomsky, Reverend Dr. Thomas Padiet, Manager, St. Berkman's College, other dignitaries, Dr. Benny Matthew, Reverend Dr. Josh George, Dr. Joseph Job, Vice Principals, St. Berkman's College, Professor P.J. Thomas, Head, the Department of English, former teachers, invited guests, dear teachers, and my dear loving students. Good evening to you all. I feel delighted to welcome everyone to the 34th C.A. Shepherd Memorial Lecture, organized by the Department of English, St. Berkman's College, Changanashiri. This memorial lecture helps us to fondly recall the memory of a doyen of this college, Professor Colin Anthony Stewart Shepherd. Sneha well explained about the personality of Professor Shepherd, and I also remember him as an inspiring teacher, delightful speaker, writer, and a director. An erudite and inspiring teacher, Professor Shepherd was a noble and dignified human being as well, whose memory is ever fresh in the hearts of his students and colleagues. Professor Noam Chomsky, one of the most influential public intellectuals in the world, has agreed to give the 34th C.A. Shepherd Memorial Lecture, which is a joyous occasion for the Department of English and the college, especially its centenary year of establishment. It is my proud privilege to welcome Professor Noam Chomsky formally to the college. I'm sure Professor P.J. Thomas will introduce this great American linguist to the audience who are virtually connected far and wide. Let me take this opportunity to thank Professor Noam Chomsky for his generosity in accepting our invitation and giving this memorial lecture. On behalf of the Berkman's community, I welcome you to this program. Dr. Thomas Padiet, our manager, does not need a formal introduction. He is with us in all our endeavors and motivates us to do the task with utmost sincerity and commitment. Dear Father, I wholeheartedly welcome you to this program. I cordially welcome our vice principals, Dr. Benny Matthew, Reverend Dr. Josh George, and Dr. Joseph Job, our former professors, heads of the departments, teachers from neighboring colleges, and those who are virtually connected to this function. I would also take this opportunity to express my gratitude towards all who sincerely contributed to this event. My special thanks to the coordinator of this event, Mr. Nitin Varghese. Last but not the least, I wholeheartedly welcome my dear students to this function. Welcoming you all once again, I remain, thank you.
Thank you, Father. Now I invite Professor P.J. Thomas, the head of the Department of English, to introduce the speaker.
Thank you, Sneha. I apologize very sincerely for the initial delay and mix-up. So good morning, Professor Chomsky, and good evening to all the distinguished participants who have joined us from across India and beyond. It's my distinct honor to welcome you all again to the 34th Shepherd Memorial Lecture to be delivered shortly by Professor Noam Chomsky, who is the legendary scholar, teacher, philosopher, computer scientist, linguist, and above all, the public intellectual of our times. I thank you all for your support. I am more than certain that I should be brief. Moreover, I don't think an elaborate introduction is necessary or even possible about Professor Chomsky. He is visible and known to all of us as the Rocky Mountains are to the Americans, the Alps to the Europeans, the Himalayas to the Asians, and the Atlas to the Africans. However, please allow me to do this short and sketchy introduction as my duty today. Professor Chomsky is currently the Laureate Professor of Linguistics and Agnes Nelms Harry Chair at the University of Arizona, where he is offering courses on biolinguistics and meaning and language, meaning in language and society. As we know, he had a long stint at MIT before. Considered the founder of modern linguistics, Professor Chomsky is one of the most cited scholars in modern history. His groundbreaking books include Syntactic Structures, Language and Mind, Aspects of the Theory of Syntax, and the Minimalist Program. He introduced Chomsky hierarchy, generative grammar, and the concept of a universal grammar, which underlies all human speech and is based on the innate structure of the mind and brain. Who can ever forget his classic sentence, colorless green ideas sleep furiously, we are all familiar with. Professor Chomsky has not only transformed the field of linguistics, his work has influenced fields such as cognitive science, philosophy, psychology, computer science, mathematics, childhood education, and even anthropology. Professor Chomsky is also one of the most influential public intellectuals in the world. He has written more than 100 books and is one of the recent being Requiem for the American Dream, the 10 Principles of Concentration of Wealth and Power. He has not only studied linguistics deeply and theoretically, but also used language and writing to catch the conscience of the king and even that of the world. So it's a historic moment for our department and the college when Professor Chomsky gives this lecture today. I deeply and profusely thank Professor Chomsky. This talk also made history with around 5,000 registered participants, the highest ever for a talk of this nature. And that is Professor Chomsky. So with the deepest sense of gratitude, honor, and love that I can imagine, let me welcome Professor Noam Chomsky to deliver the 34th Shepherd Memorial Lecture on the topic reflections on language and thought. Now over to Professor Chomsky. Thank you for accepting our invitation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. A good place to start is at the beginning, 2,500 years ago. It's as far back as detailed records go. That's when the Delphic Oracle issued a pronouncement defining our primary task, know thyself. Well, that's a two-word aphorism, can be interpreted in many ways. Given what we know today and what should be uppermost in our minds, a reasonable way to interpret the oracle is in collective terms, as urgent advice to understand what kind of creatures we humans are. And we are indeed strange beasts, at once the pride of evolutionary history and at the same time the scourge of the earth. It's a challenge to find out how this could be, and an imperative to find it out in time so that we can fend off the worst and aspire to the best. Humans appeared very recently, some 200,000 to 300,000 years ago. That's a blink of an eye in evolutionary time. Not surprisingly, there's very limited diversity among us. Evolutionary biologists tell us that a small troop of monkeys is likely to have more genetic diversity than all humans on Earth. The slight differences are what matter for life, the commonalities we take for granted. For understanding ourselves, the proper stance is the opposite. What is deeply important and most revealing is what is common to us, and what distinguishes humans so radically from all other life on Earth. Variation is superficial. For good reasons, then, we should interpret the advice of the oracle collectively. What kind of creatures are we? What are the species properties that are common to all humans, apart from severe pathology, and are without significant analog elsewhere in the living world, even among our closest relatives, the higher apes, what paleoanthropologists call the human capacity? When we inquire into this question, I think we find two striking properties that satisfy this austere criterion: language and thought. At least thought in any way we can grasp and study. It's language and thought that enable humans to issue the proclamation of the oracle, to reflect on its meaning, to seek to find answers to the questions it awakens in our minds. And the same is true of the most mundane experiences of ordinary human life, all common to humans, and in important ways, distinctive to the human species. Well, if inquiry reveals two distinct properties that virtually define the species, the next question is, what relation holds between the two? The simplest answer would be the relation of identity. Language is a system for generating thought. Thought is what is generated by language. That, in fact, is the answer that was given at about the same time as the pronouncement of the oracle in classical India by the famous Sanskrit scholar Bhartra Bharhari, one of the founders of the great tradition of Indian grammar and philosophy. In his words, I'll quote, "Language is not the vehicle of meaning or the conveyor of thought. Rather, it is the generative principle of thought. Thought anchors language. Language anchors thought. Using language is thinking, and thought vibrates through language." Similar ideas resonate through intellectual history. Well, moving a long distance, the 16th century Spanish philosopher Juan Huarte set the stage for the first cognitive revolution that followed shortly after by emphasizing what he called the generative quality of human understanding, unique to humans. the capacity that we constantly exercise in normal life in using language to construct new thoughts, to interpret the thoughts of others. Huarte also identified a still higher form of intelligence that enables some to create work of true intellectual and aesthetic value, while the rest of us, lacking this talent, are able at least to enjoy and appreciate it, sometimes to carry it forward. Another species property that derives from the language thought complex. Huarte also insisted upon the universality of language structure, on the brain as the material site for cognitive functions, along with the generative quality of human understanding. These ideas have been revived without any awareness of the long forgotten history in what's called the cognitive revolution of the 1950s, which was a sharp break from prevailing doctrines, though with a rich historical background that was then unknown. These ideas had flourished during the 17th century scientific revolution in Europe, which laid the basis for modern science. Language did not escape the attention of 17th century thinkers. Galileo, the logician linguists of the French Port-Royal Monastery, expressed their awe and wonder about a remarkable fact. With a few symbols, each of us can construct infinitely many thoughts in our mind and can convey to others, with no access to our minds, their most innermost workings. For Descartes, about the same time, the normal creative use of language employing this capacity was a foundation for his establishing a second substance, res cogitans, mind, relating language and thought, a capacity unique to humans. Galileo himself regarded the alphabet as the most spectacular of human inventions because it captured this marvel. Galileo's amazement was echoed centuries later by Gottlob Frege, the founder of modern logic and logical philosophy. Frege, in his words, found astonishing what language accomplishes. With a few syllables, it expresses a countless number of thoughts, and even for a thought grasped for the first time by a human, it provides a clothing in which it can be recognized by another to whom it is entirely new. The amazement of these great thinkers is entirely warranted. This insight poses what we might call the Galilean challenge. How is this achievement possible? The challenge seems to me to capture lucidly the major task faced by the inquiry into the nature of language and thought, in fact, into the unique nature of the human species. The Galilean challenge initiated a rich tradition called general and rational grammar. General because it sought universal principles underlying human languages. Rational because it sought to go beyond description to explanation. Throughout, language is generally regarded as closely bound to thought. The common understanding was captured simply in the 19th century linguist William Dwight Whitney's phrase that language is audible thought, though now we recognize that sound does not have that unique status. The great humanist, founder of the modern research university, Wilhelm von Humboldt, he went further. He identified language with thought, much like the early Indian tradition. He characterized language as a generative activity and pondered the fact that somehow this activity, in his words, makes infinite use of finite means, basic feature of the Galilean challenge. Well, Humboldt's formulation of the Galilean challenge brings to light a serious gap in the millennia-long tradition. It failed to accommodate Aristotle's crucial distinction between possession of knowledge and use of knowledge, contemporary terms between competence and performance. The tradition kept to use of knowledge, more specifically, use of knowledge in production of speech. Little was said about perception of language, a prime concern of modern psycholinguistics. Both production and perception access the knowledge that is internally possessed, the main topic, but not discussed. The reason was that appropriate means were not available at the time to formulate clearly and to investigate the fundamental task, to unearth the system of knowledge possessed, the internal language, what's called I language, internal language in technical usage. This gap was overcome by the modern theory of computation, created by Alan Turing, other great mid-20th century mathematicians, and adopted in the modern reshaping of the tradition. These tools made it possible to resurrect Aristotle's forgotten distinction between possession and use of knowledge. These tools made it clear how a finite mechanism can have infinite output. Notice that does not entirely resolve Humboldt's puzzle about prediction, but it makes it possible to carve out a domain of feasible inquiry, the study of the generation of the knowledge possessed with finite means and infinite scope. Production of language, which makes use of this knowledge, like other creative activity, is beyond the reach of inquiry in any fundamental sense, as is even simple voluntary action. These are mysteries for humans. The distinction between generation and production of language is fundamental and commonly misunderstood. Generation lays out the terrain. Here are the linguistically formulated thoughts, infinitely many of them. Production is an activity that makes use of these thoughts, commonly in innovated and creative ways, in a manner that's not understood. In Cartesian terms, our use of language is appropriate to circumstances, but not caused by them. We are incited and inclined to speak in certain ways, but not compelled. And Huarte's higher form of creativity is still more mysterious. Well, the new tools of the theory of computation made it possible for the first time to develop explanatory theories of language that yield an infinite array of hierarchically structured expressions that constitute thought and can be externalized in some sensory motor medium, usually sound. We can call this the basic property of language. Soon as this enterprise was undertaken, mid-20th century, serious problems arose. The structuralist behaviorist consensus that prevailed at the time had no real puzzles. Everything essential was known. Procedures of analysis could be applied to any corpus of materials. But as soon as the search for explanation began, turned out that almost nothing was known. Virtually every sentence poses new puzzles. Furthermore, the elements that were postulated in the best theories could not possibly be found by a schedule of procedures, just as in every other branch of science. Explanation in the language case has to proceed at two levels. What's called a generative grammar of a language is a theory that seeks to explain the properties of the language, the knowledge that's possessed by the user of that language. At a deeper level, the theory of the shared language faculty is concerned with the innate factors that make language acquisition possible, factors that distinguish humans from all other organisms. In modern terms, that's called universal grammar, UG for short. It's adapting a traditional term to a new framework. Well, if you take a look at UG, it has goals that appear contradictory. It must meet at least three conditions. First of all, UG must be rich enough to overcome the problem of what's called poverty of stimulus. The fact that what is acquired demonstrably lies far beyond the evidence available. That's the first task. Secondly, UG must be simple enough to have evolved under the conditions of human evolution. Third, UG must be the same for all possible languages, given the fact that there is no biological adaptation to specific languages. We achieve a genuine explanation of some linguistic phenomenon only if it keeps to mechanisms that satisfy the joint conditions of learnability, evolvability, and universality. But these appear to be at odds. The course of theoretical inquiry has been driven by the goal of reconciling these conflicting requirements. These problems were evident at the outset of the generative enterprise. We now know that they're considerably more severe than what was then envisioned. With regard to evolvability, genetic studies have shown that humans began to separate not long after their appearance. There are no known differences in language faculty, which means it must have been in place before separation. Furthermore, there is no meaningful evidence of symbolic behavior prior to the emergence of Homo sapiens. Well, putting these facts together suggests that language emerged pretty much along with modern humans. That's an instant in evolutionary time. If so, we would expect, and it hasn't changed since, so we would expect that the basic structure of language should be quite simple, the result of some relatively small rewiring of the brain that took place once and has not changed in the brief period since. The apparent contradiction with learnability becomes much sharper. And research on language acquisition has extended the dilemma farther. It's shown that a child of 2 or 3 years old who is producing only very short and simple sentences actually understands far more complex ones, and in fact has mastered the basic properties of its language, including some quite remarkable ones. Furthermore, statistical study of the data actually available to the child shows that the evidence available to the child is very sparse. These discoveries seem to require that UG must be very rich in order to overcome the enormous gap between data available and knowledge attained. At the same time, the condition of evolvability demands that UG be very restricted, and the problem of apparently endless variation lies in the background. Well, in the past few years, some hope has emerged to resolve this tangle of dilemmas within what's called the minimalist program. We can get a sense of how by looking at a fundamental and quite puzzling universal property of language, what's called structure dependence. So consider the properties of this very simple sentence, properties that are mastered by children as young as they can, as experiment as possible, maybe 30 months of age. So this, take the sentence, the boy and the girl are in the room, are in the room, not is in the room. Actually, that raises puzzles to determine the agreement of the verb. The child does not use the simplest computational rule, adjacency. Instead, the child reflexively relies on something it never hears, the structure that its mind creates. The child then assigns plurality by virtue of the nature of this abstract structure. Well, that problem quickly extends. So take the following two sentences. The bombing of the cities was a crime. The bombings of the city were crimes. To decide whether to use was or were, singular or plural, we ignore linear adjacency and we attend only to the structure, the total noun phrase subject. But we have to go beyond that to find the central element of the noun phrase, bombing or bombings, the more remote noun. That turns out to be a non-trivial computation, far more complex than linear order, which is reflexively ignored. Well, let's take it a step further. Consider the sentence, the mechanic who fixed the car carefully packed his tools. It's ambiguous. Could be the mechanic who fixed his car carefully, or it could be the mechanic carefully packed his tools, either way. Now put the adverb carefully in front of the sentence. carefully the mechanic who fixed the car, packed his tools. It's now unambiguous. It means that he carefully packed his tools. The adverb carefully seeks a verb, but it cannot use the simplest computation. Pick the linearly closest verb. UG forces us to ignore the simplest computation and to select the more remote verb, which happens to be the structurally closest verb, as we see when we assign the structure in what our mind tells us is the correct way. Well, it goes without saying that none of this can possibly be learned. There is, in this case, supporting neurolinguistic evidence. Experimental work has shown that when subjects are presented with invented languages modeled on actual ones, the language areas of the brain react in the normal way. But if the invented languages use very simple rules involving linear order, there's diffuse activity in the brain, indicating that the brain is treating it as a puzzle. It's not activating the language areas. So we therefore have a serious puzzle. The infant ignores 100% of what it hears, linear order. The infant attends only to what it never hears, and its mind constructs abstract structures. Furthermore, this is true for all constructions in all languages. Well, the only possible answer is that linear order is simply not available to the child who is acquiring a system that constructs thoughts. So why then does speech require linear order? The answer is obvious. The articulatory system cannot produce structures. So the externalization of internal language must impose linear order on an internal system of generation of thought, which is unordered, purely abstract. Actually, sign language is less strictly linear because of wider options available in visual space. The sensory motor systems that are used for externalization have nothing at all to do with language. They were in place millions of years, long before language emerged. They have not changed since. True language is the internal system that generates thought, the I language, internal to an individual, coded as a generative product procedure in the brain. Well, we now face the question why the infant reflexively ignores 100% of what it hears, linear order, and attends only to what it never hears, abstract structures created by the mind. We know, we recently have learned that there is a straightforward answer. Satisfaction of the basic property requires a computational procedure. The simplest computational procedure is what's called binary set formation, putting two things together to make a new thing. It's called merge in current work. It's easy to show that if generation of our knowledge is based on merge, then structure dependence is imposed and there's no linear order. And there are many consequences of this. One is that certain thoughts become inexpressible in speech, even very simple ones. So to illustrate, let's shift from conjunction and to disjunction or. So take the sentences, either John or Mary is in the room. Either the girls or the boys are in the room. What about either the girls or John is in the room? No good. Either the girls or John are in the room. No good. Neither is possible. The thought is very clear. And if number agreement were based on adjacency, could easily be expressed. But with structure dependence, the thought is inexpressible without extensive paraphrase. This is one of many examples of conflict between optimal design and utility for communication. There are many others that are far more serious than this one, and they're all resolved in the same way. Communicative efficiency is always sacrificed. To put it metaphorically, when Mother Nature was constructing language and thought, she was concerned with optimal design, not with how the system might be used. If it turns out to be dysfunctional, so be it. It's worth noting that that's how evolution works generally. We can distinguish three steps in normal evolutionary change. The first step is innovative. Some disruption takes place by accident, maybe a mutation, or maybe a bacterium accidentally swallowing some microorganism, as happened once, that led to complex cells, eukaryotic cells, the basis for complex life. That's the reason why there's anything other than bacteria in the world, one accidental event. That disruption introduces something new. Then comes reconstruction. Nature redesigns the new system in the simplest way, satisfying natural law. These are matters that are discussed in some depth in classic work of Darcy Thompson on laws of growth, by Alan Turing on creation of patterns by physical law. The final stage of evolution is winnowing. Natural selection reduces the variety to the better adapted. The simplest solution produced at the second stage may turn out to be dysfunctional, but nature doesn't care. In reconstruction, nature seeks optimal design. It has no way to consider possible functions. Well, language seems to fit the normal pattern. We can envision an evolutionary scenario that looks something like this. Some small rewiring of the brain yielded the general property of recursive enumeration. It's unique to humans. Nature then took the natural course, seeking the simplest such operation, relying on natural law, in this case, principles of computational efficiency. It is a computational system. The result is a system based on merge, satisfies the basic property. Its deepest and most surprising property, structure dependence, follows at once with its ramified consequences. UG encodes the outcome. The infant, therefore, reflexively ignores everything it hears and attends only to the abstract structures that its mind creates. In these terms, we can envision a resolution to the conundrum facing UG. The diversity condition, the third, can be put to the side in the study of the core system of generation of thought. The variety of languages seems to be localized in peripheral aspects of the lexicon and in externalization. Perhaps completely, we might someday learn. The research seems to be tending in that direction, and it would be a very natural outcome. The poverty of stimulus conditions on the core system are severe, sometimes clearly insurmountable, as in the case of structure dependence, clearly unlearnable. Furthermore, the amalgam of the sensory motor system and the eye language poses a cognitive problem, which can be solved in many ways. So it wouldn't be at all surprising to find that it's the locus of the complexity and mutability of language, along with the variety of languages, all superficial, if these ideas are on the right track. So at least for eye language, the conundrum is largely reduced, maybe totally reduced, to satisfying the evolvability condition, the second one. And that problem will be overcome to the extent that the structures of eye language are generated by the simplest operation, what's called the strong minimalist theory, sets this outcome as a prime goal of the theory of language in the modern period. And there is considerable success in pursuing the strong minimalist thesis. Well, these observations reinforce the traditional view that language is essentially a system of thought. The modern doctrine that language is basically a system of communication that may have evolved from animal communication seems completely untenable. Well, returning to the evolutionary scenario, the winnowing stage, the stage of natural selection, may never have been reached, probably because the system designed at the reconstruction stage is so tightly integrated that it's either all or none. Either have it or you don't. So no natural selection. That's increasingly what we find when we investigate more complex cases. Well, instead of going on to further cases of genuine explanation, let's turn briefly to a different direction. Eye language is a computational system. Any such system has primitive elements, atoms of computation, and it has computational procedures to form new elements. That's what a computational system is. For language, the primitives are the minimum meaning-bearing elements in an so-called analytic language like English, where the words are simple, strung out one after another, not much morphological complexity. In such a language, these are often words. So you have major books with titles like Words and Objects or Words and Things. That's W.V. Quine, leading philosopher of language of the 20th century, Roger Brown, who in mid 20th century initiated the study of language acquisition. These titles, word and object, words and things, they reflect the standard view that words and mind external objects are linked by a relation of reference. For the sciences, establishing such a relation is a norm, That's what you're trying to do. So when scientists speak of uranium or genes, they hope that there are such things in the natural world. It seems that animal communication observes this condition. There's a one-to-one relation between the signals, let's say a monkey call, and some physically identifiable event. That seems to hold for all animal systems. But there's very good evidence that human language does not observe this referential doctrine. We do use words to refer, but referring is an action. It's what the British philosopher John Austin 60 years ago called a speech act. When we look closely at the meaning of words, it's very hard to sustain the idea that there is a word-object relation. So take a standard example in the current philosophical literature, a supposedly logically proper name, like London. Well, I can perfectly well say that I'm planning to visit London again after it was destroyed by fire, rebuilt 50 miles up the Thames with different materials and different design. Perfectly intelligible thought. No one believes that there's a real world entity with such properties as these, complex mixture of abstract and concrete. The fact is that the word London is not a proper name. Rather, it's a city name. And our mental concept, city, has rich and complex properties. These are carried over when we use the word London in the speech act of referring. But there is no reference relation between the word London and an object somewhere out in the external world. Well, this observation generalizes to the whole vocabulary that's used to refer, the vocabulary that's used to relate internally generated thought to the external world. The basic point was recognized by Aristotle. The example that Aristotle used was the word house. He observed that a house is an amalgam of what he called matter and form. The material part of the house is what a physicist could identify: bricks, timber, etc. The form of the house is a mental construction. The design, the intention of the architect, the characteristic use, so on. So something could look exactly like the place where I live, but actually be a library, or a garage, or a stable for horses, or even a paperweight for a giant. These are not properties detectable by physical examination, but they're crucial properties of the meaning of the word house. Nobody could possibly be taught this. You don't find this information in the most detailed dictionaries, but we all know all these things for every word in the vocabulary used to relate language to the world. Well, even earlier than Aristotle, a similar point was made by the pre-Socratic philosopher Heraclitus. He asked a simple question: how can we cross the same river twice? Its material component has changed. Turns out to be a deep question. A little thought shows that under radical material change, it can remain the same river, while under very slight changes, it will not be a river at all, maybe a canal, maybe even a highway. That turns out to be true, even of the simplest words that we use. Well, these features of language and thought raise new conundrums. All of this must be known without learning. Correspondingly, must be shared, and apparently is shared, cross-linguistically in fundamental respects, slight variation at the margins. Studies of language acquisition have shown that these items are acquired on very few presentations. That implies that they're based on rich innate structures. They're in the mind prior to learning. Learning is apparently a matter of settling relatively superficial properties. There are no analogs to such concepts in animal symbolic systems. There's no record of their development. For these reasons, the origin of human concepts has seemed a hopeless mystery, buried deep in the prehistory of Homo sapiens. But on reflection, that seems most unlikely. The rich and intricate concepts that are the atoms of computation would have no function at all outside of a system of generation of thought that yields complex expressions that can enter into reasoning, reflection, other mental acts. If these concepts had emerged before language, they would have been useless waste, would have been discarded. It's reasonable to suppose then that when the capacity emerged for recursive generation of linguistic expressions, it appropriated a lexicon of elementary items that were available to proto-humans. And only later, as the combinatorial possibilities of generating language and thought became available, concepts of the distinctive human character appeared. How, we can only guess, but it might be possible to explore the question if it falls within the history of humans. Well, more is being learned about the rich, inventive, creative lives, complex social orders of the tens of thousands of years of human history that are now becoming in part accessible to inquiry, and new and helpful insights into these questions might be coming into view. Following these paths, we might hope to gain some real insight into the nature of language and thought, fundamental features of the human capacity. Fundamental, but of course, not all-inclusive. When we look around us, we see other striking features of this strange creature that has recently appeared on Earth, bringing with it language and thought. These other features are not our topic today, but it might be useful to devote at least a few sentences to them. We all know that humans are facing likely environmental catastrophe. South Asia happens to be the most endangered area. It may soon be unlivable if current trends persist. The rest of the world lags not too far behind. We should also all be aware that there are feasible means well within reach to avert catastrophe and to move forward towards a better world. They are known and available. Well, a week ago, an important event took place in Glasgow, Scotland, COP26. Actually, there were two events. One event took place within the stately halls of the meeting. Another event took place in the streets. Within the halls, respected men and women debated solemnly and reached a few conclusions about how to deal with the worst crisis humans have ever faced. The most important decision they reached was to meet again next year while the world continues to burn. In the streets outside, another event took place. Tens of thousands of people, mostly young, demonstrated, called for a commitment to use the feasible means available to avert catastrophe, to guarantee them and their children a life worth living. Well, which of these forces will prevail? That's not a topic for speculation, but for actions. Actions in which all of us can and must participate if there's a way, any hope, if there's any hope for the survival of organized human society and for the huge number of species that we are destroying right now in our blindness. In comparison with this question, no other ones matter. Thank you.
So can we have a quick Q&A, question and answer session, Professor Chomsky?
We have time for a Q&A.
Hello?
Do you have time for a Q&A?
Do you want me to start with the questions that are here?
Do you have time? Do you have time? Do you have time for Q&A?
Can you look up Yanis and see if he wrote back? Well, which question? I see a lot of questions. Which one's the
one? Professor Nitin, are you there? Please.
What seems at the top is.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please pick up some questions and read. So we will read some questions, Professor Chomsky.
We have a lot of questions here. Maybe, Professor Chomsky, could we have your thoughts on.
Start with the top.
Artificial please, intelligence and language, if that's fine by you.
Seems to be a major threat to language development in the present day. How do you perceive it? Well, artificial intelligence began about, at the same time as the generative enterprise that I've been discussing. The two, in fact, were closely related. Generative grammar was just part of artificial intelligence. Most of it was going on, in fact, at the research lab where I was working, research lab of electronics at MIT. Artificial intelligence since then has pursued two different directions. One direction is essentially science, trying to find the nature of human intelligence. That was Alan Turing's conception of artificial intelligence. Also some of the early leaders of the field like Marvin Minsky. And as I say, generative grammar is just part of that, trying to understand the nature of thought. Artificial intelligence used a particular mode of experimentation, namely constructing models using programmed computers. Now, you shouldn't be misled by that. When people talk about a machine doing something, say a machine thinking, what they mean is a program doing something. The machine does nothing. It's just a thing sitting there implementing a program. So the program is the one that's doing the operations. Well, what's a program? A program is just a theory written in a notation which enables a machine to implement it. So this form of artificial intelligence is the effort to construct theories of intelligence, human intelligence, and to make them precise enough so that you can put them in a notation in which machines can implement. That's one branch of artificial intelligence. It's pretty much died out. There aren't many people doing that. What's called artificial intelligence today is a form of engineering, trying to find useful things, to find programs that can carry out acts that are useful to us. There's nothing wrong with that. Engineering's a fine occupation. It's good to have automobiles that work. It's good to have the Google Translator or the transcription system that's enabling me to read these questions. But it's not science, it has nothing to do with science. It tells us nothing about language, nothing about thought. It's a useful device. And that's the dominant form of what's called artificial intelligence today. So when you read excited stories in the newspaper about what machines are able to do, bear in mind that they're able to do nothing. The programs are able to do nothing that relates to human intelligence. That quest has been pretty much abandoned. Everything based on, say, deep learning is apart from the science that Alan Turing was concerned with, the science of human intelligence. May have very valuable outcomes, like a lot of engineering does, but it's not a threat to language development unless we decide to misuse it. You can always misuse the achievements of engineering, but we don't have to. We can use them intelligently. Let me see if I can go on to another question. My question is this. In the opening of Camus' L'Étranger, he writes in French, "Aujourd'hui, maman est morte." The seemingly simple transition of the word maman makes the reader view the main character, Marceau, in a multitude of ways, thus throwing Camus' thought on the subject in question. In the light of this, is language meant to be understood as the sender of the message thinks of it? Is their thought relevant once they convey the same thought through the medium of language? Well, notice that this is speaking of the use of language, what Aristotle called the use of knowledge, not the knowledge itself, not the internal thought system. So the question is, when we use what we know, is the language meant to be understood as the speaker, the sender, what the sender has in mind, or what the hearer has in mind, or in some other way? There's no answer to that. The expression that was produced is a sentence which happens to be effectively shared by English and French, different sounds, and it has an interpretation as a thought. The speaker who's using it may have all sorts of thoughts in mind when he or she uses the sentence. The hearer who perceives the sentence, again, may have all kinds of thoughts and background used to interpret it. All of these are real. None of them is right. They're just three different things related by the fact that they all emanate from a common thought in the nature of the essentially shared universal language. But there's no answer to which is the right one. Next, how do you foresee linguistic creativity by AI, and how may it differ from human linguistic creativity? Well, in my view, it differs by not existing. Linguistic creativity by AI is just using patterns that are extracted from huge quantities of data, many supercomputers, astronomical quantities of data, deep learning program searches them, finds patterns, produces new things on those patterns. That's not creativity in the human sense, not the kind of creativity that Indian philosophy 2,500 years ago, Juan Huarte, early Galileo, Descartes, not the kind of creativity they were talking about, or not the kind of creativity we mean in ordinary human life. It's finding patterns, using them, period. If that was all humans did, there would be nothing significant created. But humans somehow are different. We somehow have these higher, unique higher capacities of true creativity. Shows up in ordinary life, shows up in this simple conversation. In this simple conversation, you and I may be using thoughts, linguistic expression of thoughts, which have never happened before in human history, but they're appropriate to the situation. We can understand them, use them as a basis for our own reflection, and so on. That's normal life. Sometimes there is this higher form of creativity that Huarte referred to, which we don't understand. It's the kind that has true intellectual and aesthetic capacity. Some Beethoven's quartets, Einstein's theory of relativity, things we can admire, appreciate, maybe do something with, but most of us, certainly not me, are not capable of creating. That's true, the highest level of creativity. Is it that the more we understand speech acts and intricacy involved in understanding grammar, the more we are inclined to suspend judgments, to suspend use in Aristotle's terms of use of knowledge? Well, the more we understand the nature of what we do, the more capacity we have to do new things, but the more humility we have when we realize how much we don't understand. It's a standard fact about science. Those of you in the sciences are familiar with it, that whenever you discover something, you find the thrill of discovery, the satisfaction of answering questions, and the challenge of dealing with new questions that have arisen that you never thought of before. That's part of discovery, the excitement of discovery. You see that with a young infant. Young children are extremely curious. They're trying to discover what this strange world is. They discover a simple fact. I watch it with my great-grandchildren, 10 months old, pick up a little ring and bite it. It's exciting. They didn't know they could do that. Then a little later, they see a place where they could put it down. They do that. That's exciting. Then they find another one with a different color and they put them together. They're learning more each time. Every time they do something, more of the world comes into view. You're understanding a little bit more about how things work, and you're finding new challenges that you hadn't conceived of before. That goes on all through life, goes on all through the sciences. So physics has reached an extraordinary degree of understanding, but you can pick up a journal of quantum physics today with a symposium on the question, what is a particle? The most fundamental notion. And you have six different ideas on what a particle might be, and nobody really knows. In fact, 95% of what's postulated as what exists in the universe, 95% of it can't be found. We have every reason to believe it's there because the theories don't work otherwise, but you can't find it. Well, that's a challenge. The challenge that's asked by this question is similar. We don't understand speech acts. We know we carry them out. We know how to do it. We have some grasp of them. When we investigate Aristotle's possession of knowledge, we learn a lot about them. Like the few things that I discussed, we learn such things as that. That increases our capability to make use of speech acts effectively. But it also opens the door to humility in recognition of how little we understand about the world. That's exciting. That means there are challenges to deal with, exciting ones, new territory to explore. That's what makes science and much of life exciting. And
Excuse me, Professor Chomsky. Sir, I'm Nitin Varghese. So since a lot of questions in the chat box, I think I'll select and read a few questions too. Would that be fine?
I'm sorry.
There are a lot of questions in the chat box. So it would be difficult for you to read all those questions and give the answers. So can I read, select a few and read those questions to you?
I'm very sorry, but unless something is put down, I can't really hear it.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes.
Sir, there are a lot of questions in the chat box. There are many questions in the chat box, plus some comments, some appreciation messages and all.
I'm going to have time only for one more because question. I have another coming up in a few minutes.
Okay, sir. Sir,
can you pick one, or shall I just take the last one?
Okay, sir. So this is a question. So what so would
in
be
a country like India, where there are more than 200 languages, Hindi is seemingly the most dominant. Hindi speakers are most commonly referred to as Indians. There have been many cases throughout India where the non-Hindi languages are degraded, seen as un-Indian or as the other. What are your thoughts on language being used as a device to establish a hegemonic system in a country like ours? Well, it's the same, maybe not as extreme, but it's similar in other countries. So in the United States, there's a form of English known as Black English. It's the language of the Black, the Afro-American communities. When I was a child living in Philadelphia, if I took the one block from where I lived was a Black neighborhood. I couldn't understand the children in the streets. They couldn't understand me. We just spoke varieties of English, but different languages. Well, the Black English was regarded as not a language, just some primitive noises. Of course, that was, we now understand perfectly well that that was total nonsense. If Afro-Americans had the wealth and power in the country, we'd be speaking Black English, and my language would be considered degraded in noises. None of this is tolerable in a decent human society. Each language, each culture is of comparable value in itself, just as each person is. There should be no hierarchies, no domination. They're almost all totally illegitimate and should be overcome. In India today, this is a very serious problem with the rise of efforts to dismantle Indian secular democracy and to establish a kind of Hindu ethnocracy. It's a very sad and dangerous development. India had been a flourishing democracy, a model to the world in many ways. To see that destroyed is a real human tragedy, and every effort should be made to prevent it. And the same is true of the case of Ur-Indian degraded languages and so on. That's all. From a scientific point of view, it's nonsense. From a human point of view, it's deplorable. And all efforts should be made to overcome it. It's true in the United States. Steps are being taken, not enough, but at least some. Even much more true in India with its rich variety of languages, which should be regarded as a cultural treasure, something to be respected, admired, encouraged, used to enrich the society. If we were all alike, life would be impossible. The richness, variety, excitement of life comes from the differences among us. As I mentioned, from a biological point of view, the differences are extremely slight. Humans are virtually identical from a biological point of view. But from a human point of view, these differences among us are what make life worth living. We should help them flourish and develop in any way we can. Afraid I'll have to leave you now. Much to my regret, I have another talk coming up in a few minutes. Yes. So,
Professor Chomsky, can you remain for a few minutes? So he left.
A little, no. I have none.
Just we have a word of thanks. Yeah, please.
Okay, thank you, Professor P.J. Thomas. Good evening, all. I apologize for the delay and the confusion that occurred at the beginning of today's lecture. Please accept our sincere apologies. Well, we have been listening to...
Nitin, can I take a second? Because there's a very significant coincidence today, because tomorrow it is the 93rd birthday of Professor Chomsky. So there are requests from participants to wish him a happy birthday. So happy birthday to you.
This is a great way to celebrate it.
Yes.
Happy birthday to you. Thank you.
Okay. So, well, we have been listening to, I would say, a scholar par excellence in American theoretical linguists, perhaps one of the most influential public intellectuals in the world for the last 1 hour. So thank you, Professor Chomsky, for this wonderful lecture. It was a pleasure listening to you. On behalf of St. Workman's College and all of the participants here who have undoubtedly benefited from your session, I offer you our gratitude and thanks.
Thank you very much.
Okay. So with a deep sense of appreciation, I thank Reverend Dr. Thomas Padiyat, Manager, Reverend Father Ajithi Kurian, Principal, Dr. Benny Matthew, Reverend Dr. Joseph George, Dr. Joseph Joe, Vice Principals, for their unflinching support. Professor P.J. Thomas, Head Department of English, for his untiring effort and coordination. We have been fortunate enough to be backed by a team of very proactive and dedicated teachers and a team of students. Therefore, I would like to thank the people who work behind the scene. A special thanks to Dr. Vimal Mohan John, Mr. Ranish K. Joseph, Mr. Jeremy Sebastian, Ms. Sneha George, and Roger Sebastian. Finally, the wonderful participants who have turned up in such large numbers, not only from our college, but also from other departments, colleges across Kerala and outside Kerala, and even abroad. Thank you so much for your cooperation. Thank you, everyone, once again for making this event a grand success. Thank you. Goodbye. Good night. Thank you, sir.